I am the least qualified to be talking to you. Truly. You've been listening to people who've done things. Without them, we wouldn't be here, and that wouldn't be available to the people who live around here. Knowing about the natural world and being in contact with the natural world is the most precious inheritance that human beings can have. You've been listening to people saying what has been they've been doing and doing it with humour and with modesty. But they've done very, very important things for which not just you, but people all around here should be grateful. We're losing species, we're losing land, we're losing much that is so precious. So it's marvellous to be here seeing actually the reverse. Seeing actually things getting better. We should celebrate that, and we should certainly thank the people who are responsible.
Are a wonderful resource. They're a splendid open space. A lot of wildlife come there, and it would be a tragedy if we were to lose them.
We were living in Aberdeen with our young children. My husband was a community worker. Our families are from the south. And he applied for and got a job with Hackney Council as their community officer. And in those days, they were housing key workers. So they offered him the job and they said, we can offer you a flat. They paid for us to come from Aberdeen to look at Lincoln Court. I remember them bringing us in here and we looked out and we thought, oh, that's a nice view.
Independently, Elaine and I had found out something about the history. Sir Hugh Middleton took on the job of building this river to try to bring fresh water to London in the very early 17th century because people were dying of plague.
He refers to it as my immortal work, Sir Hugh Middleton.
It started operation in 1613. It ran into trouble and the King, James I, had to help out. And in 1619, the New River Company was formed.
When Thames Water, as it then was, the Thames Water Authority, led by Roy Watts, announced the investment in the London Ring Main, they also announced that they no longer required the use of the New River and all the associated waterworks, the reservoirs and pumping stations, adjacent to the New River from Ware in Hertfordshire all the way down to here in Stoke Newington. That was a bit like lighting a blue touch paper.
We first heard of Thames Water Authority's plans to abandon use of the New River water supply system south of Cheshunt, which affected Stoke Newington reservoirs and the filter beds, when we were at a Woodberry Down Tenants Association meeting in October 1985. There was this very brief statement. it was so brief, one or two sentences, and yet the impact was going to be so huge. And Thames Water Authority were a formidable opponent. We knew already that they demolished buildings in Lordship Road and at New River Head when they were due to be listed. And of course they had the backing of the government in terms of privatisation and the money that would be released by developing the sites that were no longer needed.
We were so appalled at the prospect. We thought, well, what can we do? So quite independently we wrote a few letters to different people.
Alan, my husband, and I were on holiday in Skye, and we phoned home for some reason, and my daughter, who was here, said, "You just won't believe this. Thames Water are going to build on the reservoirs." And I can feel it now. I mean, it just ruined our holiday. We couldn't believe it. The campaign got going very quickly. I didn't initiate meetings, but there were quite a few of us from here who very quickly started going to the meetings, which were usually held in the John Scott Health Centre in an evening. And it kind of snowballed, really.
Some of the key people I can think of right at the beginning, one was an artist, Louise Whittles, who produced the logo that we were to use with the geese flying and the pumping station in the background. Councillor David Clark, he was appointed as chair. Michael Lewer, who lived locally, was a barrister, QC. And David Pracy, who was a librarian, at that time I think at Brownswood Library. And it was this core that would meet in this flat in Rowley Gardens. I remember very clearly the evening that the council officer, Jean Fraser, came and presented us with a cheque for £2,000. We established ourselves as the Save the Reservoirs, New River and Filter Beds campaign. I think over a period of 10 years, there were many other people who took very significant roles in the campaign.
Well, at the moment, the threat to this reservoir is the Thames are threatening to drain it and breach the sides. So it's a built-up side. The West Reservoir is no longer needed when the ring main is completed.
My job became taking the publicity around Stoke Newington Common. The Hackney Show was very big in those days. And taking photographs. Very quickly we accumulated papers, I don't know, leaflets, all sorts. So, you know, to really kind of get the publicity out, I think.
We discovered one week that Kenneth Baker, the Secretary of State for the Environment, was cutting the first sod of earth at Stoke Newington Reservoirs to start the London Ring Main, which was going to supersede the New River and our beloved reservoirs. And so we thought, we've got to do something. He said, on our doorstep, we got the idea that I should dress up as Sir Hugh Middleton in early 17th century costume.
I'd made this scroll that Dad was holding.
Save my immortal work.
Yeah. You continue to be wheeled.
I dressed up as Hugh Middleton at every opportunity. Well, when I went and spoke to schools, I always went dressed as Hugh Middleton. Well, I didn't go. I changed there. Bit difficult on the 29 bus.
The man in the middle there with the white hair is a Queen's Counsel. And he looked at the legislation and realised that the only way that Thames Water could get rid of the New River would require primary legislation. And primary legislation is like gold dust. He raised the question as to how are you going to do this, Thames Water, without primary legislation. And they realised that they couldn't.
The most appalling thing, the people who now look out from their windows and their gardens and watch birds, geese and ducks landing on the filter beds would look out on unloading bays for large superstores, and adjoining those superstores they have laid out a space for a car park for 1,100 cars.
I got involved in 1994. I was working for a private architectural practice and living in Stoke Newington Church Street. My partner got involved because he was a keen fisherman. There was a fishing tackle shop at Newington Green called Ashpoles, and the fishermen in there believed that there were large carp in the lake. Everybody came to it from a different angle, I think. The campaign was really good at publicity, so 2,500 leaflets went out.
We would have had a newsletter editor, I think in those days we used some pretty crude methods of producing newsletters. I think they were cut and paste jobs. There were lots of people who used to gather in Brownswood Library and on the floor and cut up copy that had been typed up and pasted into the sheets before it went to the printer. We devised this strategy to halt Thames's plans for the West Reservoir, and if we could for the filter beds, but we knew that we had little chance. So we'd have stalls for the Stoke Newington Festival, and people would come along and sign the petitions and buy the badges. Somebody wrote a poem about it, which was on a postcard. So there were all these devices for raising small but significant sums of money to enable us to campaign effectively.
All sorts of local people have just been taking petitions around their streets and writing to Thames Water and doing all sorts of things to let people know that local people here really care about the reservoirs. So at the moment my feeling is that what we need to do is, as a community, make our voice heard.
I think it's one of the very few sort of green lungs that the borough has, and it's quite unique in its particular form, and is the sort of thing that we perhaps tend to undervalue while it's there, and then we'll wake up too late when it may have been built over, at least even if only in part, and we'll then bemoan, well, why didn't we fight harder to keep it? I think it's the sort of thing that you only really appreciate once it's gone, unless you're careful.
What do you think of the wildlife and the birds?
I think it's quite
nice to have it around.
Yeah, it's nice because there's a family of four herons that we saw back there.
And there's just loads of birds and fish and everything.
Hackney's great-great-grandparents paid for these reservoirs, and now they're no longer required to supply water. Hackney children drew up their plans for the reservoir's future.
Thames Water, however, wanted to redevelop the West Reservoir as housing alongside the filter beds, and some of us said that wasn't the deal. We then developed a much more high-level, high-profile campaign targeted at saving the West Reservoir to stop pulling the plug, and a block of shares in Thames Water was purchased, which were then divided up into singletons. We had a friendly lawyer who delivered us a sheaf of share transfer certificates so that we could break up the block of shares, which I'd purchased them. So we got on with that business so we could flood Thames Water's annual general meeting.
As it turned out, we were at the beck and call of all manner of people as time went on.
And this led to our MP getting an adjournment debate in the House of Commons in 1989.
It's very important that we show Thames Water that we're not going to allow them to pour concrete on our reservoirs and sell them off for profit.
She asked us to go along to her committee rooms where we briefed her.
In the 29-acre Stoke Newington Reservoir and Filterbed site in my constituency, we have what one might call a secret garden. My constituency is one of the poorest areas of the country and is in one of the most built-up parts of the inner city. Yet right in the middle of it, we have a site the size of Regent's Park, which is an oasis, a green lung, for hundreds of thousands of people in Hackney, Haringey and Islington. Above all, it serves as a green lung for thousands of my constituents who live on the huge council estate on Woodberry Down. The wildlife and the water on the site will be swept away. The site will be turned into a yuppie stockade in the middle of my constituency. All the possibilities of the site and all the community access to it will be lost forever. I leave the social problems inherent in that yuppie stockade to the imagination of the House. But there will also be traffic problems and the divisiveness of creating an extremely expensive development in the middle of a poor area. What is more, the proposed development of the site endangers the New River, which has flowed for so many years.
Hackney Council made it known that they would accept the responsibility for the reservoir, and that was very important. Thames were not prepared to pass an interest either through a leasehold or a freehold to a non-statutory body. Interestingly, Thames had started to tell fibs about the actual structural state of the West Reservoir, claiming that it was unsafe. And another of the activists was able to demonstrate they'd been economical with the truth. So Thames Water recognised at a high level that they were not in a very strong position to resist the campaign. As I say, the local authority then agreed to take on the responsibility for £1, I think was the consideration that was paid. And when it became clear to Thames Water that they were going to get planning permission for the filter beds, they became very generous, I think, it could be said.
We'd kind of won the battle with the reservoir, and I think they'd filled it back up again with water. There's a 106 agreement that would be a sort of endowment to build the water sports centre that they were already thinking of doing. In my capacity as an architect, I pulled together a scheme, an alternative scheme for the filter beds. Three of us took it to show to Jeremy Corbyn, and we went for tea at the House of Commons. He was, you know, he was great. He kind of looked at it very carefully, and he kind of commented on how you could improve the design and so on.
I'm a bit fed up with developers turning up to local authorities and basically negotiating with them and saying, well, look, you know, you agree to this development, that development, and the other, and we'll give you a little bit of community facilities as a result. I don't think that's an acceptable way to go on. Secondly, local authorities are not any longer in charge of their own planning policies, because the Secretary of State can always call a decision in if he wishes to and reverse it or alter it or set up an inquiry about it. So at the end of the day, the decision is going to be taken by the Secretary of State. What I would hope is Hackney would be firm in saying these are public assets. They were publicly built. They were built for the good of the people of London. The needs of the people of London have changed and developed a bit. The technology of delivering cheap and clean water to people's houses has changed. Let's use the reservoirs for wildlife, for popular recreation facilities.
A couple of people on the very active on the committee lived in a place. I think their flat overlooked the filter beds. And that was hard for them, because I suppose in a way the filter beds just were not used. They were kind of, you know, I think we knew fairly early on that we were going to lose those, and in a way, well if we lose those we might gain other things, which was what happened really.
There was a lot of issues really, you know, obviously the wildlife aspect, and then, you know, having it as a place where schools could come and learn, people could learn to sail, you know. And there's quite a lot of young people who may be a bit disaffected by school, but, you know, actually the skills that you learn doing water sports are, you know, where you can use different skills that you don't actually tap into if you're stuck behind a desk at school, you know. So, no, I mean, we think we were all committed to that idea, definitely.
If these reservoirs had been built on, you wouldn't be able to see the types of homes and communities that we now have growing up around the reservoir. And for Woodberry Down residents, they were always very clear they didn't want all the views and the best homes to just be private homes, so they're very mixed. You've got a community centre on the reservoir, you've got parks running down to the reservoir, and it's very much opening up and saying these are spaces for the community.
We lost the filter beds, but we saved the reservoirs and the new river. David Attenborough came to open them. Walking out, people stopped and said, thank you. And this was worth it, wasn't it?
This is part of our heritage. This is what makes life important and living worth living. This is a source of joy and solace that everyone should have. Thanks to the people you've just been listening to and to many more out there, that is available, the heritage, for anyone living around here, for free. Congratulations to you all, you've been heard speaking. Congratulations to all you who I know are standing here who brought this about. This is a great day. Long may it be remembered, and may there be another one like it before too long. Thank you very much.